and welcome to Forgotten America, a podcast about the many places that get flown over, driven past, or just plain forgotten, and the people who call these places home. In each episode, we'll diagnose the unique challenges faced by rural America and unpack and explore the solutions to those challenges. We'll also share the culture, stories, and perspectives of forgotten Americans, from the hilltop to the holler and the desert to the delta. Dan Corcoran joins Forgotten America to discuss men's issues and why he feels our modern culture is leaving men behind. Statistics across a variety of sectors show that men are struggling with mental health, criminality, friendship, overall well-being, purposelessness, and society's perception of men. Dan and Garrett discuss these issues, how they affect men, and ways we can improve the lives of boys and men.
Welcome back, everybody, to another edition of the Forgotten America podcast. As usual, I am your host, Garrett Bounty, CEO of the Cardinal Institute, and I am joined today by Daniel Corcoran. Daniel, you host a couple podcasts that we'll get into here in a little bit, but you brought to me a really interesting topic that I want to sort of set the stage for, if you'll allow me just a couple seconds here. So I'm going to read some statistics because I think this is really interesting, if not a little bit depressing. 15% of men today do not have a close friend, a fivefold increase since 1990. Men are four times more likely to die by suicide, yet are 10 percentage points less likely to seek mental help. 71% of opioid overdoses are men. 10 million working-age men are neither working nor are they looking for work. 80 to 93% of men comprise the prison population, depending on what your source of statistics are. So, Dan, you reached out a few weeks ago and you said, you know what, Garrett, I'd like to talk about men. And I have to admit, I got a little bit excited. This is something I've been thinking about for a while now. And I think really up until maybe 2 or 3 years ago, this would have indeed been a forgotten conversation. I think men have kind of faded into the background. Before we get into the meat of this, Daniel, why don't you introduce yourself a little bit? And just tell our listeners why you are interested in this topic.
For sure. First off, Garrett, thank you for having me here today. It's an absolute pleasure. And before we go into everything, a little bit about myself. Currently work at a large tech company, but I have a number of passion projects outside that, completely divorced from my full-time, say, profession. And one of those was a political podcast I hosted for approximately 4 years and had on guys from across the political spectrum, where we dived into these pretty sometimes contentious topics, but always sought out to remain respectful. And over the course of those 4 years, one topic kept coming up, along with a couple others, but that topic was boys and men's social issues, health issues, economic issues. And I felt that there was a need in this space because another issue I'm extremely passionate about is free speech. And when I see free speech being under attack, I also see certain organizations such as FIRE countering that, as long as a number of other people across the political spectrum, which is encouraging. But when I see these boys and men's health issues that are, you know, empirically being documented rigorously, I don't see anyone in this space. And that is what brought me here because, you know, about a year ago, I put together a small team, four of us, all young men, individual leaders in their own right, to participate in a roundtable discussion where we would be dissecting the contemporary landscape for boys and young men. And that's exactly what we did. And we're currently releasing those episodes. But that's where I'm heading towards, I would say, through in my life. I want to move there more in a professional sense as well in the future. And as I mentioned, the reason why I want to talk about this and the reason I'm passionate about it is because I feel like there aren't too many others who are, and that needs to be rectified immediately. And that's what brought me to this state.
All right, I'm going to take you back to your elementary school days or maybe your high school days. I always had teachers that would ask me, what is the problem statement, right? So what is the issue that you're trying to solve as you see it as it relates to men's and boys' issue, broadly speaking. So give me the problem, and we'll get to the solutions a little bit later, but just diagnose the problem for us, Daniel.
For sure. And, you know, that's quite the loaded question, but more than happy to tackle it, because I would look at this as there's tentacles to this problem. And I would say, before getting started, I always like to put out there that no one can take away one's own power to improve their life. And I think individual agency is key in this. Like, there is an ending of the problem that people are responsible for how their lives play out. But having said that, there's also structural factors that can influence those decisions and those people's lives in a pernicious way. But the problem, I would say, overall is boys are struggling in a number of domains, some of which you laid out, you know, quite acutely, whether it be in education, in the workforce, in the homes, mental health, and elsewhere. And it's well documented. So one could reasonably ask, like, why isn't it being discussed? And the reason why it's not being discussed, partially, in my opinion, is the fact that there is a hostile culture towards boys and men. And when I say hostile culture, what I mean by that is that you can throw out these contemporary terms such as mansplaining, manspreading, toxic masculinity, small dick energy. And I even give you a more recent comparison too. So I don't know if you heard of the men and bear comparison. Like, would you, for a woman, it was mainly asked to women, if you were in the woods, would you rather be stuck in the woods with one man or a bear? And overwhelmingly, people responded with the bear. And it's hurtful, but two, they go, men do this, men do that, men do all these things. And you're like, okay, well, when you really look at the data, and this is coming from the FBI crime statistics, 0.01% of men were convicted of rape in the year, I believe it was 2022. 0.1% or 0.2%, excuse me, were convicted of a violent crime. Now, that's not dismissing those valid concerns, but it's more so saying, like, do we think 0.01% of bears are violent? Probably not. Most bears are pretty violent given, say, the circumstances. And I want to bring it back to your question and not, like, completely dodge it. The issue is that boys and men are struggling across a number of domains, and we can easily see that, and it's been well documented, but it's not being taken on because it's not popular. You bring this up and you hear a wince or a sneer. It's not welcomed among, say, polite circles. So that's what the problem I'm looking to take on. And I'm in communications with quite a few people on how we can do this, but it's most likely going to be through the way of starting a nonprofit and having individual pillars that cater to these issues, these individual issues. And not everything could be addressed, obviously, but at least taking it head on and unapologetically.
So that's a very good overview. So I think some of these things are related. So one of the statistics I threw out early on in the conversation was this idea that men are just so much less likely, Daniel, to reach out for help on a given issue, right? We're meant to sort of internalize our problems, right? Kind of suck it up, buttercup kind of mentality, which is useful in a lot of different situations, but it can also be a little bit self-destructive. And I wonder if that is why, that's a part of why we're not really having this conversation in a serious way, is because men are not really going to speak up for themselves, right? And I think that's what you're trying to do. And I know Richard Reeves and others are doing some interesting things. Do you agree with that? That part of the reason is men are just afraid to kind of speak out about this because they feel like they're going to be seen as feminine in sort of way or whining in some type of way?
I think that's certainly a possibility. And I do want to limit my authority figure on this issue as I'm still relatively new, but I do keep up with Richard Reeves, Scott Galloway, George the Tin Man, that's his Instagram alias, but puts out fantastic content that I recommend anyone checking out. But to your question, I think it is an issue to an extent, but you know what a larger issue in my estimate is? Let me give you an analogy. If you were walking down the street and someone ran up to you and broke your arm, and you're like, oh my God, my arm's broke, and everyone around you was like, you have to go to a hospital, get that fixed. You have to go to a hospital, get that fixed. And you're like, okay, sure. You go to the hospital, get fixed. But don't you think it'll also be beneficial to arrest a man that's going around breaking people's arms? And that's what society is failing to do, because what they're doing is they're telling men rather patronizingly, just talk about it as if it's this internal issue that men have to like just deal with. It's internal completely. And sometimes say it is. But you can also look at the criminal justice system that has a bias towards men. You know, there was a pretty well-documented study that came out of the University of Michigan Law Center a little while ago. But nonetheless, it saw that when men and women are convicted of a crime, men are get 63% more of a longer sentence. And when they're both convicted, women are twice as likely not to be sent to prison. And then you also look at family court systems, for example, and see that they can be quite heavily skewed in a lot of states as well, in terms of the mother being looked at as the primary custodian. And that's not just in America. There was a European journal that did quite some good research at this that looked at Brazil and Argentina as well as different countries and their court systems. So I do agree that if a man is going through an issue mentally, it should not be suppressed. Having said that, I think a lot of times there are men going through these existential issues and they're just told to talk about it as if that's going to, quote, solve the problem. For any other group that has these kind of issues, charities are formed, boards are put together, millions of dollars are funded to solve the problem and to support that demographic. But when it comes to men overall, it's nothing.
So Daniel, you had alluded to this sort of, you guys are breaking down the crisis that men are having right now, kind of in different pillars. So if you don't mind, I'd like to kind of go through those pillars individually. Yeah. So I think this is what you're talking about. Education, men in the home, culture, and mental health. Are those sort of your organizing pillars on this issue?
So those are, I would say, some of the domains where men are struggling. Okay. But when I say of pillars of a nonprofit and how we would tackle it, it'd be three pillars. One would be education, but not your, say, formal education, like providing education to men. One in the form of courses. And that would be built out by subject matter experts in their respective fields. And what I mean by that, too, like, what are these courses? Well, something you spoke to earlier is that there's a fivefold increase in males not having one single friend from the 90s. And that's an issue. We see that isolation could be a contributing factor in male suicide and probably suicide overall. So one thing that guys, obviously, I would say, are not the best at are staying in touch with one another post-high school or post-grad. I reach out to people once a quarter, and they'll be like, Dan, you're fantastic at staying in touch. I'm like, I'm reaching out to you once a quarter saying, hey, what's up? How's it going? So it's like in these courses, not to get too far away from the point, it'll be providing men profound knowledge and actual takeaways to improve their life and improve their well-being. So that'd be one pillar to take on the issue. And that kind of goes into that individual agency aspect I was speaking to. But then also another pillar would be community and networking opportunities that we would like to develop. And those opportunities would come in the form of, say, conferences, but also other community events. And these conferences would feature expos of businesses that are really oriented around improving one's well-being. So that could be fitness clubs, martial arts studios, that could be clubs, that could be professional development. That could even be a barber, because, you know, a lot of guys struggle with getting a good haircut, especially in their 20s and 30s when they have that receding hairline. So we want to boost confidence. We want men to feel good about themselves, be more confident. And at these conferences, there will also be educational programming sessions, how to navigate relationships better, how to approach a woman. Because we also see that women still want to be approached by guys, but a lot of guys are worried about coming off as creepy. There was a survey that was covered by Date Psychology that saw that surveyed men and women. And between the years of 18 and 30, for women, 77% of them said they still want men to approach them. So obviously it depends how and who, but overall that's there's that expectation still. And I don't think there's anything inherently wrong with that. It's just guys should know, let's do that the right way and let's develop ourselves and let's bring a better, let's put our best foot forward. So that'd be the second pillar, you know, community events, networking, developing ourselves in that regard as well. And then thirdly would be through advocacy and legislation. So there are a number of federally funded offices that address and take on girls and women's health issues, social issues, economic issues. And I take no issue with that. That's totally fine. But there's not one out there that is comparative for boys and men. Not one. And that needs to be remedied. That needs to be rectified immediately. So that would be, those are the three pillars that I laid out to you that would take on this issue. And will it be perfect? God, no. But will it be at least a step in the right direction? I'm confident.
So I do not believe in monocausal explanations on anything, but let's kind of go back. Let's rewind the story a little bit, Daniel. As you've thought about this, what are some reasons why you think men are struggling today?
I think it depends on where we're talking about. So like economically, let's look, for example, you could go far as back as say the Industrial Revolution. People talk about how the Industrial Revolution was kind of happened and because showing emotion was say related to negative productivity or decreased productivity, that is when men start showing less and less emotion. Because there's also this distorted view of masculinity that, as you kind of allude to, that masculine men don't show emotion. And that's couldn't be farther from the truth. Going back from the Iliad, even, you know, in those historic writings, they talk about how the Greek soldiers wept at the death of one of their leaders. And Marcus Aurelius, in his personal journal, Meditations, talks about how the true strength of a man is measured through kindness and humility and not through the angry whiners. So I'm not trying to go on a tangent here, but it's really hard, I would say, to root cause all of it to one thing. But I mean, let's stay in that economic vein. So the US is moving much more towards a service-based economy and knowledge-based economy. And men, generally speaking, were gravitating more towards physically laborious jobs, like in steel plants and coal mines and just manufacturing overall and other physically intensive work. But now that's a lot of that has been offshored. And then that kind of requires this recalibration towards knowledge-based work and usually typically requires a college degree. And then we now see that more and more women are enrolling in college and less men are enrolling in college. So that's kind of an issue if the staple piece to a high income life is going to be dictated by whether you have a college degree or not. So that's an issue for sure. So I would say that's one way to kind of dissect it, is just like looking historically, how has the economy changed? And maybe that hasn't like benefited men entirely or their interest. But it's even hard to say interest sometimes too, because there was a university, Brown University, put out a research paper a little while back, not too long ago actually, that looked at 4 and 5 year olds, both boys and girls that had these behavioral problems such as delayed gratification, can't sit still, can't pay attention, yada, yada. And for similar acts, boys were punished more harshly. And to be even more specific, black boys. But just boys overall were punished more harshly, were penalized more often for those acts. So, and the reason that's relevant too is because that can affect educational outcomes as well. If you're being penalized at like a young age and you're not doing well in school, and that's not even from only, that's not exclusive to a conduct perspective as well. There was a good research done at the University of Trento, which is in Italy, and they surveyed almost 40,000 10th graders, 15 and 16 year olds, and they gave them a standardized test that was graded anonymously, and then a test that was graded by teachers. And on the standardized test, it covered language and mathematics. And on the standardized test, the girls did better, which is in line with a number of other studies that they do better in language. But in mathematics, the boys did better across the standardized test, and once again, in line with other studies as well. But when it came to the teachers, it was not graded on par with that at all. So women, girls still did better in language sections of the test, but did also better than boys in the mathematics part. And boys were deducted to the point of like not failing, like the average. It was out of a range of 10. Girls had like a 6.4, 6.5, and boys got 5.9, which was not in line with the standardized test, the anonymous standardized test. So I know I'm kind of jumping all over the place, but this, to your point, not everything's monocausal, and there's a lot of contributing factors to this. But I think, to your point, we're kind of starting to dig up the surface of some of these issues that may be affecting boys and men. And that's why it may feel like a lot, because they existed for, say, a while, but now we're just finally having the research done to substantiate those claims.
Daniel, let's take this conversation into the spiritual realm for a second here, because I do think if you had a gun to my head and you said, Garrett, tell me why men are experiencing a crisis right now, I think if I thought about it, my answer would be vaguely something like lack of purpose, mm-hmm. right? So, and it goes back to what you said, at least on the economic side of things, right? Where physical power is less and less useful now, right? It's just, we don't need it as much. We have a bulldozer to dig holes. Construction is largely done by massive machines now, and not quite so much mm-hmm. the bicep or the tricep. If you look at fatherhood is sort of less necessary in a rote, raw kind of economic way, right? The state has sort of moved in and provided material wealth to children and wives and mothers in a way that the state did not, not all that long ago. I mean, really since the 60s and 70s. If you look at even in martial areas, in the military, right? Our military is much more diverse than what it used to be, which is probably a good thing, frankly. It's also a lot smaller than it used to be, right? Manpower is being replaced by things like drone power, which again, is probably a good thing. But if you survey it on a kind of a spiritual or even metaphysical realm, men are experiencing a lack of purpose, right? And I think one of the problems of, let's say, like delayed marriage, women have sort of an imputed purpose to them, right? They bear children, right? Men do not have that luxury. We do not have that sort of deep biological purpose rooted in us. And so if you delay something like marriage or you delay something like fatherhood, it becomes that much more likely that you're going to live sort of a rootless existence. So I'm curious, what is your first blush response to that sort of purposelessness epidemic that I'm describing?
Well, it's like, why, I think to myself, like, why am I even here, like on this podcast? And it's that, it's to find its purpose. And I do think a lot of guys lack that, because I can't exactly root cause it, but I think that's also more acutely seen in Gen Z too. And that could be possibly not settling down later in life. And you go to work for a large company or any company and you don't feel maybe aligned in the entirety of their mission. But I kind of think of it this way too, like the economic liberation of women and independence is great and it's fantastic and it's neat and it obviously was a huge win for society and humanity overall, you know, in the United States. Obviously across the world that differs in like certain countries. But I always kind of see it as it's something that women can maybe opt in and opt out of, like my honest opinion, because they could go to, they find a partner and they could settle down and have a child, and that becomes their purpose. And then on my personal podcast, I spoke to someone, a young mother, who wasn't too thrilled about like joining the workforce. It's just not what she exactly wanted to do. And she had a child with her partner, and she's extremely happy about that. You know, she's thrilled. It gives her purpose and meaning every day. For men, you can't really opt out of the economic output. You have to participate. And I think that puts a lot of pressure on finding something that may fulfill you. And that's hard. How am I going to find something that fulfills me so young, and when I don't really know too much about myself, I'm still discovering things. And as you said, like, people are getting, say, married later and selling down later. So I think that could, and maybe that's not always like the desired result. Like, as we're saying, like, men are struggling in the dating scene. I believe, I don't have the exact statistics, so I don't want to speak erroneously, but, or inaccurately, but I know that a lot of men just haven't had sex in like the past year, and also haven't approached a woman, at all in their entire life. What is going on here? And Jonathan Haidt would probably have some commentary on all this from just studying Gen Z and how is now how we're having more of a phone-based childhood rather than a play-based childhood, as he would call it. And that really kind of leads to a number of pernicious outcomes that are unsavory, and that could once more hinder one's own social development. And when the man is expected to make that approach and ask the girl out on the date, like, it's quite intimidating. It's quite daunting, especially if you have underdeveloped social skills. So I don't exactly have the exact answer, but I mean, I think purpose is huge. I think if you meet someone who has a purpose-filled life, like, they're a happy person, because you could be like someone who's rich and they have a lot of money. It doesn't mean they're exactly happy. But when you say someone has a family, it doesn't mean they're exactly happy. Like, hopefully they are, or if they have a good paying job. But when you say someone has a purpose-filled life, they have a purpose, I would say they maybe are happy. And honestly, I would take to conclude on this, I would even take the Jordan Peterson kind of view on this, that I only know happiness would be the best proxy for the optimal life. I think happiness, like all other emotions, they're fleeting. They're going away as sadness and anger comes as well. So I think a better way to orientate oneself would be towards purpose overall, and not say happiness. Happiness is great, and you should welcome it, as Peterson would say, but it's coming and going, just like sadness, anger, love, grief.
I want to get into some folks that you would, maybe towards the end of the discussion, but some folks that you would recommend people kind of check out in terms, if they're interested in the subject matter of this conversation, that you feel like would be valuable additions to their bookshelf. But Daniel, what do you think? I think it's so important for men to understand what being a healthy, purpose-filled man looks like. I think the statistic is something along the lines of 1 in 4 children are now growing up in a household without a father. And mm-hmm. So that sort of begs the question, well, if a young boy is not modeling their behavior off their father, so then where do they go? So the natural reaction would be, well, probably school, right? Maybe a teacher or a football coach. So then you go to there and you say, okay, well, that's interesting, but 90% of teachers in elementary school are female, right? 75% of teachers in middle school are female. So you're not really able to even model that in sort of an aggregate way. So then the next question is, well, what about pop culture? And this is where I want to go with you. If you look across, let's just use television as a medium that we all sort of familiar with, we all watch, right? Can you name a healthy male kind of role model that is portrayed in pop culture? Because when I look at pop culture, men are typically either portrayed in sort of a best case scenario, almost like an anti-hero, right? So think of a Tony Soprano or a Walter White or somebody like that, right? Or it's most often sort of like this blundering idiot who's always saved at the last moment by his got it all together wife, right? So I'm curious, have you thought about this kind of the role that pop culture has played in sort of the either the feminization of men, the demonization of men, or I think probably most often the infantilization of men, right? Which is we're just overgrown kids. So anyway, that's a big overarching question I'm going to kind of place here in your lap. But have you thought about the role of pop culture in this epidemic?
I think the role of pop culture hinders the conversation. It impedes the conversation about talking about these issues because you bring it up. And as I said, people wince at it. I did with a friend once before, just said, I gave the very innocuous statement of, I think young men need more encouragement. And it was almost as if I insulted her dead grandmother. She took such offense at that. And it's just ridiculous because what is so wrong with that statement? What is so wrong with helping boys and young men, especially children too? Like, are you that hateful that you can't even envision or imagine helping boys like it because they're simply male? Like, what are we doing here? And I think it's a huge problem. And when you have celebrities, compare men to human feces, one, I won't mention her name because I won't give her the clout, but one recently that she stated, and she was responding to an awful attack that happened in New York City park where a young girl was assaulted, at least sexually assaulted, which is terrible. But then she, you know, weaponized that and said, you know, it's not all men. If I gave you a bowl of Skittles or chocolates and three of those chocolates were covered in feces, would you still eat one of the chocolates? And first off, that wildly distorts the accuracy of, say, violent men overall by, say, 3% out of 100 or whatever it may have been. But two, it's the same kind of bigoted logic that those pop culture icons would decry when, say, Don Jr. would use it against Syrian refugees. When he said, same thing, bowl of Skittles, three of them are terrorists, would you accept them? And those same people would be like, oh, that's bigoted. And they're right. It distorts the view. It casts this entire demographic as bad and evil. And it's not good. And I think culture is everything. So those people just, it's awful because they have influence. That's the worst part. They have influence over a large segment of the population, say more women than men, obviously. And that influences those women's thoughts on the issue. And it creates more hostility, I would say, between the two genders than there really needs to be. This oftentimes people erroneously interpret like boys and men's issue as a zero sum like interpretation. But if you're talking about boys and men's advocacy and health issues, then you obviously don't care about girls and women's issues, and that's not the case at all. So I think it's counterproductive to the conversation, creates more hostility between the genders, and when I say this, I mean just like our pop culture icons in this space. And you mentioned like icons to possibly turn to for boys and young men and healthy ones. And I really think it's maybe less about healthy icons. Like there's definitely certain people I wouldn't recommend, such as Andrew Tate. But there's people I would recommend, such as Jordan Peterson. But I also think it's your relationship with the person. Like if you take everything they say is this dogmatic belief and you believe it as such, I don't think that's healthy. But I think there's a number of people in this space that offer profound lessons and wisdom towards boys and young men and people overall, such as Jordan Peterson and Jocko Willink's and a number of others, and historic figures as well, such as Marcus Aurelius.
So, and obviously we're talking about like just a giant, hairy mess of an issue here, right? And so you got to kind of break these things down to really kind of get to the root, but I do think if I could just turn a lever, Daniel, to say like this is gonna, if I'm gonna get the biggest bang for my buck on this change, it would be how do we get more young men around older men. Because I think if we can't fix from a public policy perspective, or if we, maybe the more accurate way of putting it is, we won't fix from a public policy perspective, getting fathers back in the homes. Well, what's the closest facsimile? Well, it's just providing space for young men and old men to kind of get together, right? So I'm curious, have you thought anything about that, like some solutions? You talked about some of the community things earlier about getting men together in martial clubs. I think back, you know, we see just an absolute erosion of things like the Boy Scouts or the Elks Lodge or the Moose Lodge. There's really no, all of those are either shrinking or they're allowing women into them sort of in the name of equity, right, or diversity or whatever, which is fine on some level. But at the same time, I think we've failed to recognize the need for male exclusive spaces, because men interact with each other in a very certain, in a very healthy way that they just can't with women, right?
Yeah. To your point with the Boy Scouts, too, I know they renamed it to like the Scouts of America. So now we include some all genders, which you said, you know, maybe fine surface level. But then to your point of, well, they're not doing that for the Girl Scouts, that I believe they're committed to keeping it completely just exclusive to girls. So it's like, well, what are we doing here? What's the purpose of that? But I think that's part of the community building and networking opportunities as well of putting together people that wouldn't normally see each other or come in contact with each other. And I my parents like divorced when I was like 12 or so. So obviously like male role models is like a huge thing for me. And thankfully my dad was a very active father figure in my life still, but nonetheless, like still not in the home. So that has an impact. So to your point, though, I do think it's extremely important to still have to connect young men and boys with older men who have more experience in life that can lend their expertise and their wisdom and put that forward that can actually help people, and particularly boys and men, move forward in the right direction, too. Because they've walked down the path that you haven't, and they could help, and it may not have been the right path. I think more you learn more from failures than you do successes. So I think that's important. And to your point, or to your question about how we would do that, I think the conferences would be one way. I think also not everything has to be so direct as well. Like I think sometimes men will not go to therapy because they don't want to sit down and just throw up their feelings or their thoughts onto someone. But what they like to do, and I've talked to a lot of guys about this, is something that Georgia Timmen calls side-by-side time, which is when you are in a group, could be a group activity, but nonetheless, you're going on a hut, you're doing a hike, a workout, any kind of physical activity. And that kind of creates almost this setting, this feeling, ambiance, that you could talk about your issues more openly, rather than just like me and you facing each other, me going into all my baggage or current issues I'm contending with on a day-to-day basis. And okay. I think that would be definitely a priority of finding out the right way to do that, because I don't want it to feel forced. Like, hey, we're all gonna sit down and talk about what's going wrong. Like there's nothing inherently wrong with that. That could be extremely therapeutic and beneficial to people. But for a lot of people, they just don't want to do that. So instead of saying, hey, men or women, for that matter, this is how you need to conform for like therapy to gain this benefit, it's like, well, what would you like instead? What would be more helpful? And finding the answer to that, I think, is the key.
Oh, that's good stuff. And this sort of reminds me of something. I just talked to David Bonson, who's a wealth manager. He's a National Review contributor. He has a pretty popular podcast called Capital Matters. He just wrote a book, Daniel, called Full Time Work and the Meaning of Life. And in that book, one of his main premises is like, look, work is not just, it's not a 9-to-5 thing. It's not something we have to get through. It's a fundamental part of who we are as human beings, right? And it kind of makes the biblical and religious case for why we need to give a little bit more of a thoughtful approach to the way that we talk and think about work. And one of the things that he recommends is it kind of talks about retirement almost like an epidemic, Daniel, where like people just, they can't wait to get out of the office and retire and kind of move on to the next quote unquote phase of their life, right? And I'm wondering too, if folks are listening to this and maybe they're getting close to retirement age, and in particular, if you're a male and you're maybe on the fence, I would say maybe think twice about it, right? Because David's point in his book, whenever people retire and they leave the office, they take with them a wealth of knowledge, right? To use your phrase, they take away knowledge of the paths they've already walked, right? And like you lose that in a very serious, a very real way in a workplace. And so I would say to men, if you're thinking about retirement, maybe don't. Maybe wait a couple years. Maybe try to find a way to plug your knowledge in a mentoring type of way into your workplace or into your broader community, because that's such a valuable resource. And when people retire and they retreat to their little hamlet, that's actually, I think, that's a debit to society, right? We're kind of working from a deficit whenever so many people are retiring. So any thoughts about that?
Yeah. I personally want to create a life I don't want to retire from. And I want to create a life that I don't need a vacation from. I still want to take vacations. But I think that's what vacations really are for a lot of people, are escape from their day-to-day life. And I don't say that from this nose-down perspective. I say that just from simple reality. And that's why I'm doing this. That's why I've done the podcast before. That's why I've always had something out of work, because I've seen people who put their identity into their work, in their workplace, their large corporation that they work at, and then they lose their job and they are devastated because that's who they were. Their identity was reinforced by their working environment and not anything outside of that. And I think to your point of like not retiring, though, if you are in a role that's beating you down and you're just over it, yeah, get out of there. Simultaneously, I wouldn't say just hit the beach and drink that pina colada. Do that for a couple of weeks. Tell me how that feels on week 3, week 4, week 6. I would say discover what your purpose is in life, and you get to decide that. No one else. So not your company, not your family, not your friends, you. So I think that's important too, is really just asking what is your purpose in life, and that could change as well, but like chasing that too, instead of maybe to your point of someone's towards the end of their professional career, they retire and it's like, well, what do I do with my life? My entire identity was work. That's where I got my, like, maybe I didn't like it that much, but that's where I got value from. That's where I was seen as this competent person. And that's why I advise, take that knowledge, take that experience, and do something else with it. Do something you find more purposeful with it.
And I would say this too, because I think going back to the pop culture conversation, that men have sort of become the butt of the joke in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. And I think that sort of manifests that men don't take themselves very seriously. Especially you see it in school, and I can remember this. I mean, I guarantee you, Daniel, the class clown 95% of the time is probably a boy, right? Yeah. And I think there's some echoes of that as men get older. And we talk about this sort of extended adolescence in men, right? And they've surveyed women about it. They surveyed men about it. A lot of times men, even into their 30s, are playing video games, or they're just doing things that we would typically associate with a younger boy, right? And that sort of continues. I think part of that is an offshoot of delayed marriage and delayed fatherhood and all those sorts of things. So I'll say this. Take the role of manliness or masculinity or being a man seriously, and think about what you can offer your family, if you're lucky enough to have one, or your community or your church. But take your role and who you are as a man seriously, and I think you'll start to feel that sense of purpose that we talked about earlier that so many men are lacking. Being a man is an important thing. And we need strong men in this society in order for this society to reach its potential, right? Are you familiar or a fan of True Detective, Daniel?
Yeah.
Season 1, right? You might even know the quote I'm going to point to here. There's this famous scene that Woody Harrelson's character, mm-hmm. and Matthew McConaughey's character, they're driving down the road. They're having a very interesting philosophical conversation. And Woody looks over at Matthew McConaughey's character, Rust, and says, "Hey, do you ever worry about being a bad man?" Something along those lines, right?
Yeah.
And Matthew McConaughey's character kind of stops. And you know what he says?
"The world needs men." Do you remember, Marty?
Exactly. "The world needs men, bad men, to keep other men from bad men from the door." Yeah. And I thought that was really interesting. It was the first time I'd really started thinking about the role of a man in our society today. So anyway, that was a brief tangent, but I just wanted to get into that a little bit because I think it's such a fascinating conversation. Is you have to take being a man seriously and the responsibility that comes with that, because we've sort of stripped that away in our modern world. Daniel, what do you think? I can't remember where I saw this or where I heard it, but going back to the importance of older men and younger men being together and learning from one another. In Africa, there was a wildlife refuge, and they were, have you heard this story?
Kruger National Park?
Yes. And they were, and I'll kind of speed it up here. So anyway, they're moving.
For the audience.
Yeah, they were moving a bunch of elephants for whatever reason to another part of the wildlife refuge. And they noticed that where they moved the elephants to, they had a lot of unusual deaths, particularly rhinos. Rhinos were being killed at a pretty alarming rate. And so they first thought, well, is it poachers? It became pretty obvious it wasn't. The rhinos still had their tusks and their horns and things like that. And there was no obvious gunshot wounds or anything like that. So they were looking at it and studying, and they realized that the rhinos were being killed by young adolescent bull male elephants. And so they thought, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? And so they tried a number of different solutions, and they finally landed on what would eventually work, which was, let's move in mature male bull elephants. And almost immediately, Daniel, as you know, the violence stopped. The young adolescent bull elephant stopped basically murdering the other large mammals in the area. And it was just the presence of an adult male calmed everything down. And I thought, what a fantastic example of the importance of having adult men around adolescent and young men. So I don't know if there's anything from that you want to take on our conversation, but I just thought, wow, that's actually a really fascinating example of some of the things we're talking about.
Yeah, I think it speaks to the potency of strong male role models and the damage that can occur when you don't have those in those environments. So I think that is extremely important, and something that, as you touched on earlier, that one in four fathers aren't living with their children. And another interesting statistic to that is when parents get divorced, after only a short time, one in four fathers say they never see their kids. So it's a kind of compounds there as well. But it's an issue. It's an issue. And you like, I would, role models light the path before you walk it. And that's what's helpful. That's what is extremely helpful, because in life, you're going down. You don't know if it's the right direction or the wrong direction. And it's great to have, like, quote, a mentor that is able to be like, I've been there, don't do that. Or I've been there, keep going. It might be hard now, but keep going. It's worth it. Keep doing this, keep doing that. And to your point earlier about, like, the class clown and boys being more, say, boorish overall, there's truth to that. Like, I 100% believe there's truth to that. And I gave this analogy once before, and obviously this is a little oversimplistic, but when we see a 12-year-old, if that 12-year-old still acted the same way when they turned 16, we're like, oh, there's an issue there. There's behavioral issues there, possibly cognitive ones. But we don't exactly identify that as an issue when it comes from, like, 18-year-olds to, like, my age, say 25. We're like, oh, like, you know, they're still in their 20s and they're still going out and acting a certain way that's obviously unbecoming and leading to, like, negative health outcomes and life outcomes. And that ends their life. So they have every right to do that, as long as it's not hurting anyone else, breaking any laws. But nonetheless, is that right? Should we encourage that? Probably not. And I do think just people overall should take life maybe a little more seriously. I know Gen Z is much higher in regards to suffering from anxiety and depression. But I think as Jordan Peterson would recommend, it's what can maybe help with that is taking on more responsibility in your life. Well, I see a lot with Gen Z, and I'm not trying to, you know, be derogatory towards my own generation, but one of the things is like they demand excellence but from the world, but expect nothing more than mediocrity from themselves. And that is just insane to me. It's like, if you want something to change, it may not change, it may never change, but you can't just demand it and expect it to happen. Like, take some action, especially with like political outcomes. Like, go on a campaign, do something, try to convince someone. Like, just not, we didn't get here by just like, in terms of like a functioning society, a first world country, by luck. It was by men and women who took up more responsibility. And, you know, I think a lot of people may see themselves as, well, that's not me. I'm not that smart. I'm not that talented. I wasn't gifted in that way. I think all these other people were. There's this lovely anecdote I'd like to provide, which talks to Roger Bannister. Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile in 1954, April 1954. Before that time, that belief did not exist in the universe. It was rather, on the contrary, believed that you couldn't break that, no human could break that barrier. Since 1954, since it was broken by Roger Bannister, over 1,600 people have now done it as well, including high school students. So I think the power of belief is huge. I think people need to believe that they can do more with their lives and that can help and take on more responsibility, take on more of a role in their community, whatever that may look like. And I'm not trying to preach to the choir. Like, I used to volunteer somewhere nearby, and I haven't done that in a little bit for a couple of reasons, but nonetheless, I'm not trying to preach to anyone. I'm just saying that if you want more from something, then give it more, pour into it. And that's what I'm trying to do with this nonprofit that will be started, is pouring into something, trying to contribute, trying to live that purposeful life, as we kind of touched on earlier.
You know, just a couple questions left here. Give us a sense of what your nonprofit's vision of success looks like, right? Because this is, again, this is a society-wide issue. I mean, it's a Western civilization sort of issue, mm-hmm, frankly. So give me a sense of what success looks like for you and your nonprofit.
So we're still developing the KPIs, the key performance indicators. One of those, it's going to be extremely data-driven, but, you know, on a macro sense, like 5 years down the line, 2 years down the line, what we would like, one would easily be to have that Office for Boys and Men established and be federally funded. You know, that, I think, legitimates the issue a bit more, too, of the struggles of boys and men. Another one would be these conferences in terms of those success rates and having the right turnout, people registering for the courses, taking the courses, and then, you know, applying surveys, giving them surveys. Has this improved your well-being? Yes, no, kind of. Like, really getting those rather KPIs. And, you know, on a bigger level, too, like, not to be overly ambitious, but I would love to take on certain communities where maybe suicide is more common. Like, that, we talked about isolation earlier, and I believe in like farmers in certain areas of the country, it can be it's quite an issue in more rural regions. And, you know, that would be, that's something I know quite ambitious and lofty, and some may say this is all like kind of out there, but that's something I want to take on as well, is reducing that. And then, as I mentioned, that might be a bit lofty, but still worth pursuing.
We need lofty, right? why? Yeah. I mean, our society, we need that kind of thing. And so, Daniel, as we wrap up,
followed by the action, but yes,
there you go. So as we wrap up here, Daniel, give folks some resources. Are there particular thinkers, you'd mentioned Jordan Peterson several times, and I agree wholeheartedly on that. Books, I mean, just give folks, if they want to continue to scratch this itch, where you would point them.
So by far the most illuminating resource into this issue that calls out hypocrisy, double standards, highlights a lot of key data points I spoke on today as well, is George the Tin Man. You can find him on Instagram. That is where he discusses these issues the most. And that's his alias is the Tin Man. His first name's George, and his last name is undisclosed. So that's definitely one. I said I belabored the point of Peterson enough. But his book, 12 Rules for Life, I think is deeply profound and helpful, and would recommend anyone check that out. But I think a lot of people kind of, you hear this when people want to get in better shape, and it's like, oh, I need motivation. It's like, no, you need discipline, and that transcends just getting in better shape. That's about just developing yourself overall. And that's someone I would point to David Goggins to, and I think he gets misrepresented as this hardcore guy, which he most certainly is. But if you understand where he comes from, he's really like everyone else, if not more mediocre way he started out. Like, he had no discipline, no motivation, but turned his life around, and he's quite inspirational. And his book, Can't Hurt Me, really dives into that and helps you understand where he's coming from and why it's important to challenge yourself every day and do something uncomfortable and push yourself. So that's another person. Chris Williamson, I think he's a podcast host of Modern Wisdom, taking a lot from him and the guests he has had on. So I think all those are great people. And there's plenty more. And each person's going to come with their faults, but you just have to have the eclectic point of view of taking what's helpful and leaving the rest.
100%. Those sound fantastic. I'd add maybe three here as you were talking. I was kind of thinking. Please. One, I would say just jump into Stoic philosophy. For whatever reason, I think men have really gravitated towards Stoic philosophy. You'd mentioned Marcus Aurelius earlier. I think there's something in Stoic philosophy that speaks to a particularly masculine view of the world. And so I would recommend if you're interested in philosophy, if you've never even heard of the Stoics, look it up, jump into it. It's more likely than not, you'll get something out of it. Second one is a little bit different. There's a feminist that I've long admired. Her name's Camille Paglia. She came on the scene in the early 90s, kind of a tour de force. Kind of frankly, Daniel, reminds me of the way that Jordan Peterson came on the scene maybe 10 years ago. But anyway, her name's Camille Paglia. She's a first wave feminist. But she makes some of those powerful arguments for men, for masculinity, how men are not predators, how men have really created Western civilization, all the things that we value and treasure and that we frankly take for granted. One of the things that she always likes to talk about is after a hurricane, who's going out and fixing the electricity, the electrical lines? It's all men, right? And so she kind of builds out kind of a wider conversation. So if you're looking for her female voice, a very eloquent, she's a very proud Italian, so she speaks about a million miles an hour, but she makes a very eloquent case for men. So anyway, Camille Paglia, YouTuber, she's great. She's done some interviews with Jordan Peterson. Yeah, she's done some interviews with Jordan Peterson. And then the third is kind of it came on the scene, I don't know, maybe 15 or 20 years ago, Art of Manliness. Are you familiar with those guys, Daniel?
Yeah.
So Brett McKay, they've written some books just on how to be a man. And they kind of go through things like, how do you change a tire? What are Winston Churchill's thoughts on leadership? I mean, it's a very eclectic website and collection of books. It's got a really good podcast as well called just Art of Manliness. So those are three things that I think hopefully will provide some edification on this front. So Daniel, this has been a fantastic conversation. I appreciate you reaching out to me. I'm really happy that you did. If people want to get in touch with you or kind of follow your work, how can they do that?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. It was an absolute pleasure discussing this topic and extremely grateful for it. And to your question, people can follow me on my personal account, Dan Corcoran 28 on Instagram. And then speaking to that nonprofit that we're tending to create and form, before that idea came to mind, we did this roundtable discussion with a different, what I touched on earlier, with different people. We were all based in the Philly area, young guys, and we kind of did what we talked about today, which is dissect the landscape. And that's called Mem Tomorrow on Instagram. It's actually a new episode just came out today, which we're recording. It's like the 26th or 25th. And yeah, so follow that on Instagram. You can follow me on Instagram. Definitely keep up with both those pages. We put out a lot of content, so you see a lot of cool things from the discussion, and there's a lot more to come. But thank you so much for this opportunity, Garrett. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for asking that question. It's always a great question to offer the guest. So thank you once more for all of this.
For sure. Dan Corcoran, thank you so much for joining us today on this episode of Forgotten America. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us for this week's conversation. Don't forget to subscribe to Forgotten America wherever you get your podcasts. If you liked this episode, please leave a review on iTunes. And if you would like to support the production of this podcast, you can become a patron of the Cardinal Institute on Patreon or donate at www.cardinalinstitute.com/donate.